Yes.
Okay.
And so many lists.
You don't have to remember all this. No need to do this. Over
okay,
here.
Okay, so from here, yeah, what these... they can give?
Okay. So it's like development of India. Okay, development of India, China, and Pakistan with respect to indicator of human development. Right? So over here, human development is basically, these are the indicators, human development index, rank, life expectancy at birth, men's year of schooling, GDP, people below poverty line, infant mortality rate, this and this. Right? So over here, China is moving ahead of India and Pakistan. This is true for many indicators of human development, right? So over here, you can see, over comparing all this, China is always the highest one. Here also, rank, its rank is 86, right? And over here also 76 highest. So China is always way forward than India and Pakistan. So why? Because of these two factors. One is income and one is health. So what is income? Income is basically the GDP per capita and promotion of population below poverty line. And health indicators such as mortality rates, access to sanitation, adult literacy rate, life expectancy, malnutrition, and all that. Malnourishment and all. Okay. Now, after this, Pakistan is ahead of India in reducing proportion of people below the poverty line and also its performance in sanitation. For the proportion of people below the international poverty rate, India has the largest share of poor among the three countries. Okay. So over here also, India has the largest share. And then, neither both the countries, India and Pakistan, over here you have not done anything, have been able to save women from maternal mortality, right? But in China, for 1 lakh births, only 27 women die, whereas in India and Pakistan, about 178 and 174 women die respectively. Okay, so you can again say that it's better in China. Okay, so you will quickly write down, you will just first write down the heading. Just write development of India, China, Pakistan with respect to this, and then you will write from here.
Here are all 4 points.
Yes. Done. Okay. After this, you have next topic, which is liberty indicators. So what are the liberty indicators basically? So the human development indicators given above are the extremely important indicator, but these are not sufficient. Along with this, there should be something which is known as liberty indicator. So what are liberty indicators? This liberty indicator are those indicators which represent the degree of social and political freedom to individual in a country. Like a measure, like you should have a democratic participation in the social and political decision making. Right, you should have a constitutional protection to give rights to the citizen. You should have a constitutional protection from the independence of the judiciary and the rule of law. These are basically the liberty indicators. And without including these and giving them overriding importance in the list, the Constitution of Human Development Index may be said to be incomplete and is usefulness limited. Okay, so you will write liberty indicator, and from here till here you will write.
Okay, liberty indicator examples and two lines.
A liberty indicator, the definition from here, and then the example still here. Okay.
Okay. And only last two pages left.
Yes.
Very small chapter.
Yes. After that, we'll be starting with national income.
Yes, yes. Only national income left?
Yes.
Yeah, my boards are next month. Economics yes. Is like more than.
Your economics exam is on 17th March, right?
Yes, 17th.
And as I told you, from Saturday, Friday or this Friday onwards, you'll be joining the class which I'll be conducting in afternoon on Friday. Right?
Okay.
Because we'll be revising over there Indian economy from very starting.
Okay. You will start from MCQs or big questions, because MCQs will be giving more points.
And yes, easy to remember. I will discuss everything. MCQ, case studies, SSN recession, previous year questions, sample papers, everything.
Okay, from first chapter. Got it.
Yes,
all right.
Yes.
Done.
Okay, now after that, development strategies and appraisal. Okay, so this is the thing. First of all, we will be doing developing strategies of China. So first of all, the question is, why did China introduce the reform in 1978? Okay, so China did not have any compulsion to introduce reform as dictated by the World Bank and International Monetary Fund to India. The new leadership at that time in China was not happy with the slow pace of growth and lack of modernization in the Chinese economy under the Mao's rule. So over there, they were not happy with the leadership and all that. Like, they felt that economic development based on decentralization, self-sufficiency, and sunning of foreign technology, goods, and capital had solved this thing was a not good thing. And despite of this and this, the Great Leap Forward and other incentives, the per capita grain output in 1978 was the same as it was the mid-1950s. Okay? So that's why this was the reason that they introduced the structural reform in China.
This I should write. Yeah. then.
Okay, Halima. After this, what are the various factors that led to rapid growth in economic development in China? First of all, establishment of infrastructure in the area of education and health, land reform, long resistance of decentralized planning. Decentralized this planning is basically including the local government in it, right? And then through the commune system, there was no more equitable distribution of food grains. Okay, so over commune system that everybody was getting enough food. Then each reform measure was first implemented at the smaller level. So for example, I want to start something new. So first I will test it at smaller level, then I will extend it. Then the experimental under decentralized government enabled to assess the economic, social and political cost of success and failure till here. Okay. So these were the reasons that leads to rapid growth in economic development in China.
Which makes up 4 points.
Yes.
Finish.
Okay, Harima. Now, after this, these are the reasons for the slow growth and re-emergence of poverty in Pakistan. Okay, so first is this: agriculture growth and the food supply situation were based not on the industrialized process of technical change but on the good harvest, right? So everything is based on the good harvest. So if you will have a good harvest, then your economy will grow. If you don't have a good harvest, then your economy will be in a negative trend. Okay. Second, if a country is able to build the foreign exchange at a sustainable export manufacturer, it not need to worry. Over here, they were not focusing on building foreign exchange. They were like, everyone will give us to us, like the remittance and all that, the Middle East and everyone. And because of this, they were really rely on that. Third, there was only growing dependence of foreign loans on one hand and increasingly difficulty to pay. So what they were doing, they were taking loan again and again, again and again, but they were unable to pay it back, right? So these were basically the reasons for the slow growth and re-emergence of poverty in Pakistan. Clear?
Yes. So starting from the points.
Yes, just for five.
Down. More points.
Okay. Now, after this, you will write this last one. However, during the last few years, Pakistan has recovered its economic growth and has been sustaining in 2015 and 16. Okay, so basically in the last few years, Pakistan has recovered its economic growth, right? And it's basically the registered growth, the GDP also is increasing, and plus agriculture record is even increasing in this sector as well. And plus, apart from all this, many macroeconomic indicators also begin to show stable and positive trend. So these are the recent trends. So you will write recent trends in Pakistan like this.